Joining us now to analyze today's headlines is Rahul Mahajan. He's a sociologist and author of Full Spectrum Dominance, U.S. Power in Iraq and Beyond. Hi, Rahul.
Hi, Sonali.
The death toll from Saturday's devastating 7.8 magnitude earthquake in Nepal has risen to 3,800. That's more than double the initial estimate. Tens of thousands of people remain homeless, and concerns are increasing of emergency food and water supplies running out. Bodies are still being pulled out of the wreckage caused by the massive quake, the likes of which had not been experienced in Nepal for about 80 years. The quake caused an avalanche on Mount Everest, and tremors were felt as far away as the Indian cities of Mumbai and Chennai. UNICEF is warning that hundreds of thousands of children are particularly vulnerable to waterborne diseases in the aftermath of the crisis. More aftershocks are expected, and a terrified population is spending nights out in the open. The Guardian newspaper pointed out that Nepal's earthquake was all the more devastating because of pre-existing poverty. Quote, their ability to cope with a major disaster is crippled by the lack of economic and social infrastructure that people in richer nations take for granted. Rahul, how important is it for us to point out that poverty always exacerbates such natural disasters? And we've seen this in places like Haiti, right?
Yeah, I think it is very important. You can think about Haiti, you can think about the earthquakes in Pakistan, you can think about the tsunami back in 10 years ago. And in fact, the death tolls from all of these things just vastly dwarf anything we see from natural disasters in the West. But I think there are two things going on. One of them is poverty, and the other is the level of social organization, especially as indicated by things like building regulations and their implementation. And so you see, for example, from countries that are middling income like Turkey, and the earthquake in 1999 was partly so devastating because there had been so much relatively unregulated building of high-rises. So I think that we have to look for the causes of this, not just in the natural disaster itself, but in the system of global inequality we have, and in the fact that so many countries still have states that aren't really providing for their citizens properly.
The Wall Street Journal has reported that the Obama administration has been operating under more lax standards in its drone program in Pakistan than in other countries. Anonymous officials told the journal that the president secretly signed a waiver authorizing the CIA to forego new rules for the Pakistan drone program that were conceived to minimize casualties. The guidelines, issued in 2013, were a response to widespread international condemnation of the drone war and a number of reports showing that strikes amounted to extrajudicial assassinations. The government officially concluded last week that a January 15th drone strike on an Al-Qaeda compound in Pakistan inadvertently killed two foreign captives. President Obama took full responsibility for those killings. Adam Entis, writing in the Wall Street Journal, said, quote, if the exemption of the new rules had not been in place for Pakistan, the CIA might have been required to gather more intelligence before its strike. Now, it's not clear if the tighter guidelines have been implemented even in other parts of the world where the U.S. conducts drone warfare. Rahul, are you at all surprised that the Obama administration issued these new rules and then just didn't follow them, at least in Pakistan's case?
That's a nice way of putting it. There's something funny about Obama. He's a really strong believer in the rule of law, and also in immediately circumventing it. So he totally believes in the War Powers Act, but it doesn't apply in Libya because he gets people to argue that that's not really a war since American soldiers aren't at risk. So a novel definition where you can bomb a country and not be at war. He wants to he wants a new authorization for drone strikes and other military action. He doesn't believe the 2001 authorization is sufficient, but if he's not going to get it, he'll go ahead and keep on doing the strikes he does. He talks about new regulations to try to minimize the civilian casualties from drone strikes, and then it turns out he sets them aside in the case where he thinks that it's somehow most important. So among the things set aside is the requirement that the people being bombed be judged to be an imminent threat to the United States, which means basically that if you're killing people just because they're members of an organization, you have they're not armed, they're not shooting at anyone, and they don't seem to be an imminent threat, that's a violation of the laws of war.
Right. And then here in the U.S., more than 2 weeks after a young African-American man named Freddie Gray was first arrested by police in Baltimore, Maryland, he's being laid to rest today. In addition to family and friends, Gray's funeral is expected to draw officials from the White House as well as loved ones of police victims. Gray died just over a week ago after slipping into a coma. His neck was nearly severed by a violent arrest by police. The Baltimore Police Department has admitted that Gray was delayed in receiving the immediate medical treatment that he needed. Major protests over Gray's arrest and death over the weekend resulted in the arrest of 34 people. Baltimore Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake shot back at the protests that apparently turned violent, saying she was, quote, profoundly disappointed. Now, Rahul, there's been very little attention in the news coverage of these protests to the fact that police effectively killed yet another black man, and there's a lot more focus on the violence of the protests, right?
Well, yeah, and it's deplorable. What are the sort of predilections of the news media, and also I think what are some of the default assumptions of much of the viewing public? But I think we can take it as given that this is what's going to happen when there's property damage associated with the protest. We saw it as far back as 1999 in Seattle. The main issues always get sidelined. So I think what the movement needs to say is this is an incredibly important issue. Police brutality, in this case, basically deliberately negligent homicide, and something needs to be done about it. And we have a unique political opening where actually people are very receptive to the other side of the story, and people are beginning to view police actions as a potential threat to them.
Right.
That situation, it's all the more important that protesters be very disciplined.
Thank you so much, as always, for joining us. Rahul Mahajan is a sociologist and author of Full Spectrum Dominance, U.S. Power in Iraq and Beyond. We'll be right back.